بالحب تلقاك البدور ضيف الأماني والسرور فيك العطايا والأجور يا مرحبا
What is taqwa? Taqwa comes from a root word which is wiqaya, which means a prevention or a protection. And it's interesting that the Prophet ﷺ said, "As-siyamu junnah," that fasting is a shield. And so again, this idea or concept of shielding oneself, of protecting oneself, is not only embedded in the idea of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also in the particulars through which we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Al-wudu silahul mu'min," that wudu, or the ritual purification we do, is a weapon for the believer. And what do you use a weapon for but to defend yourself, to protect yourself? So wudu is a protection. Prayer is a protection. Zakat is a way of protecting your wealth. Fasting is a way of protecting yourself. So actually what we're doing is we are creating, through this gift that Allah has given us, this protective barrier between ourselves and between those things that can harm us. And obviously the greatest harm that can come to us is the harm that we bring upon ourselves by falling into heedlessness. So the fasting is a way really of coming back to our true nature, of reminding ourselves who we are. And when the Prophet ﷺ said, "As-siyamu junnatun," that fasting is a shield. And then he said, "Fala yarfuth wa la yajhad. Wa in imru'un qatiluhu wa shatamuhu." And he should not speak of inappropriate matters, and he should also not la yajhal, and I want to go into that in a moment. It has the idea of he should not be impetuous or ignorant or behave in the way that the people of Jahiliyyah or the pre-Islamic period behaved, but I want to go into that in detail. But then he said, and if a man should oppose you, should argue with you, attack you, or curse you, فَلْيَقُلْ إِنِّي صَائِمٌ. Let him say, "I am fasting," and let him say it two times. اللهم إني صائم, اللهم إني صائم. To remind themselves that I'm fasting. In other words, I'm in a state of discipline with my Lord, because fasting is ultimately about moving to a higher state of consciousness. And that's where the Prophet ﷺ was taking people. He was taking people to a higher level of awareness. Because most of what we see out there in the world of problems and tribulations, if you actually look and analyze them, what you're seeing is people that are asleep. Human conflicts in houses, domestic conflicts, are because of pattern behavior. It's people that are literally in pattern behavior. Will remove the effects of their ignorance or their zealousness. So this jihad is a very interesting concept. And so the Prophet ﷺ was saying that during fasting, فَلَا يَجْهَلْ, let him not fall into this state of jihad. So what I would like to interpret that as reactionary state. The age of jahiliyyah is the age of reaction. And what Islam came was to remove the reactionary mode in the human being and to make him a vehicle of action, a vehicle not of reaction, not of falling into pre-programmed patterns of behavior, but actually to entering into a conscious state of awareness where you are actually functioning as a fully awake human being, that you are actually, you're not only awake to the realities of the world around you, but you're awake to your own human potentials, those God-given potentials that exist within you to actually overcome the propensities of the self, to overcome the inclinations and proclivities of human nature to greed, to avarice, to anger, to arrogance, to vanity, all of these qualities that the human beings find so easy to slip into when they're in the reactionary mode, and yet when they become awake and see them for what they are, and so they actually become lower than the realm of the beast. They become lower because the beasts are only behaving in accordance with their own pre-programmed patterns, whereas the human being has this extraordinary ability to actually overcome these pre-programmed patterns. And this was the characteristic and hallmark of the best of creation. كَانَ أَحْلَمَ النَّاسِ. He was the most forbearing of people. This is one of his distinguishing characteristics. In fact, one of the Yemeni Jews who came to Medina, when he heard that a prophet had emerged, he actually went and insulted the Prophet ﷺ. And when the Prophet ﷺ did not get angry, he became Muslim. And the Jewish man said that his father, who was a rabbi, had left him a description of the last prophet. And he said he had realized all of the descriptions in the Prophet ﷺ, except for one. He needed to test him on forbearance in the face of ignorance. Would he react, or would he act appropriately? And when he saw the Prophet ﷺ act appropriately, he knew that he was the messenger of God. And so this is the hallmark of those who follow his way. فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتُهُ. And then Allah sent down his tranquility, عَلَى رَسُولِهِ وَعَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, upon his messenger and upon the believers. وَأَلْزَمُهُمْ كَلِمَةَ التَّقْوَى. And he placed in them and caused them to be constrained by this, the word of taqwa. It's so important for Muslims to remember that this is a time of sakina, of learning this tranquility. It's a time of forbearance. And then from that emerges this state of piety, this state of taqwa, this state of wiqaya, of awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that puts you into a protective state. The goal is not to overcome your enemies in order to humiliate them, in order to subjugate them. No, the goal is to overcome your enemies in order to elevate them to a higher state of awareness, in order for you to teach them how to behave when power is placed in your hands, because power is a responsibility. And you cannot do that if you are not disciplined. And that is why the spiritual practices that Muslims have been given are in order to prepare them for sovereignty. That's really where the Muslim should be. And that's at the essence of what Ramadan is about. It's about reconnecting with your Lord, about reestablishing that bond with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this tie with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the habl of Allah, the rope that Allah has given us, which is the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, cling all of you together to the rope of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the Quran is وَهُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَتِينِ, it is the unbreakable rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the Quran. And so part of the covenant with Allah during Ramadan is to return to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to discipline ourselves to reading it, to reflecting on its meanings. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Don't they deeply ponder this Quran, or are their hearts sealed? This is a time to go back to the Quran, to reflect on the Quran. This is a time to do muhasabah, to reckon the self, to do a reckoning with the self. Where have we been in the past year? And what do we plan to do in the coming year, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us life? It's recommitting ourselves to the sacred path and to this tradition. This is the way of Abraham. This is the way of Moses. This is the way of John the Baptist, of Jesus. And this is the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the prophetic way. We're walking in the path of prophets. This is the muwatta, the well-trodden path. This is the path of the people that were closest to God. And so when we're fasting, we are sharing and partaking in a discipline that every seeker of God in the past of any prophetic tradition has done. So we are connecting ourselves with an unbroken chain of tradition, of connecting ourselves in a deep and sacred bond with every seeker of God from the beginning of time until the end of time, that we're connected with them in this sacred search to rescue ourselves and be rescued, allow ourselves to be rescued by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why it's a blessed month. It's a time for people to take the most benefit they can, not to waste the time. It's a time to turn off the television. It's a time to shut down the chatterbox, to let the tongue begin to do dhikr of Allah instead of remembering others with wrongs, instead of speaking ill of people, instead of wasting our time in empty chatter, in qila wa qala, and he said, and it was said, and they said, and she said. It's a time of disciplining the tongue. It's a time of disciplining the heart. Imam al-Ghazali says that the real fasting is not the fasting of the tongue and the stomach, but the real fasting is the fasting of the heart, where you begin to actually prevent your heart from feasting on prohibited thoughts, on prohibited concerns like doubt and fear, anxiety about provision. I mean, anxiety about provision is not tawakkul ala Allah. It's not trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's letting go of all of the fear. And one of the things about the modern world is it's a fear-based world. There's all these demons out there trying to scare people, scare them about their provision, scare them about this, scare them about that. You could lose your job. You could lose your wealth. You could lose this. You could lose, indeed, you could. You could lose it all. But if you have Allah, you haven't lost anything. Because everything, كُلُّ مَا تَهْوَاهُ مَوْجُودٌ فِي ذَاتِ اللَّهِ, just as the poet said, everything you desire exists with Allah. So seek Allah and you'll get everything you desire. Fasting, and this is how we break free of all this madness, of disciplining ourselves, of refusing to enter into the reactionary modes, entering into the obsessive compulsive demands of the self. Take this, and you need this, and I have to have this, and I must have that. It's just rejecting all of that and saying, Tawakkaltu ala Allah, I trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what this month is about. It's about trust in Allah. It's about recognizing that all the things that you need, you already have. You've always had them. They're inside you, they're with you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has always been there. Allah has never not been there. I mean, this is Iman. This is what it's about. And this is what all of the demonic forces and dark forces in the world out there, they're just trying to tell people that no, none of that's real, it's not true. You have to be in this state of fear, you have to be in this state of need, you have to be in this state of want. And those are the things that make you miserable. Those are the things that make you miserable. It's accepting the real truths, the truths that the prophets brought. Those are the things that give human beings this equilibrium, this state, this ability to be in the world and to maintain one's dignity, to maintain one's self-discipline, to stay in the world and be a positive force in the world, be a force that's changing, that's bringing light into the world, that's educating, edifying, taking people to higher levels of understanding. That is what Islam is about. And that's what Muslims are meant to be doing. And all those people out there that are abusing Islam, all those people out there that are not living up to the truths of Islam, to the compassion of Islam, to the mercy of Islam, to the demands of Islam, that we go out in the world with humility to take this deen. And those who accept it, they're our brothers. And those that reject it, they're still our brothers, because we're children of Adam. And we see them as people that need to be protected. And those are called the Ahlul Dhimma, the people that live under Islam who are not Muslims. They're still, the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُحِبَّ لِأَخِيهِ مَا يُحِبُّ لِنَفْسِهِ. None of you truly believes until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. Imam An-Nawawi in his commentary said, and that brother includes peoples of other religions because of the Adamic bond that we have with them. So that brotherhood is a brotherhood of an Adamic bond. And so when we look at people out there who are not Muslims, we should look with the eye of compassion, with the eye of commiseration, not with this eye of arrogance, with this eye of contempt, because that's spiritual pride. And that's one of the things that will prevent you from entering into paradise. Because when you look and see people out there that have not been given the gift that you've been given, you have to recognize that it's an arbitrary God that chose you over that person. That's a God that does what he wants and gives to whom he pleases. That you cannot see it as that you're better than that person, or that you're, that's a type of arrogance that enters into the heart, and that's from the devil himself. That's from shaitan. So you look to people with compassion, and you look to people that they have yet to be guided, and that as long as they're taking breaths, that the possibility for guidance to come into their hearts is always there. And we should never despair of people's guidance, because it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who does what he pleases, to whom he pleases, when he pleases, where he pleases, with what means he pleases. That is our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so my advice to myself and to all the brothers and sisters is to take this opportunity to use Ramadan, to make it a time of prayer and a time of peace and a time of recitation of the Qur'an, a reflection of the Qur'an. Get rid of the television. Turn it off. Don't allow it on during these months. Put it in your closet. Disengage. Fasting from all of this madness. Don't look at any of the advertisements, because it's not just food and drink. It's about fasting from those things that make you heedless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
We welcome you, month we all adore. We pray for happiness and more. To all the people, open up your door. Peace, love and joy. Let them soar, let them soar. Ramadan, Ramadan.
Oh.